Good morning! And welcome to Just Church. I'm Pastor John. Pastor Rachel will be bringing the message in a little bit. It's all about type eights, which I am, so you'll learn a lot about me and all those other eights out there. We are just happy that you're with us, whether you're online or whether you're here at this park. God's delivered another glorious day. Amen?
Amen, amen.
Amen. Nice breeze out here. We're loving it. We just want to say thank you for being with us. We're hoping that the Spirit of God is just going to be here and flood this place. So we just want to start out this morning just laying it out in surrender to Him. So join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank You for all that You do. We just want to turn our hearts and our minds to You, Lord. Help us to surrender. Help us to trust. Help us to be obedient. And help us to lift You up and praise Your mighty name. Oh, Father, we need You. We need You in all aspects of our life. We know that when we are able to be led by the Holy Spirit, that all things are for our good. And all things can be done right in Your ways, in Your will. So help us come into that place today, Lord. Help us to put down the things of this world and just focus on Your ways. Holy Spirit, invade our spirits. Mingle with us, Lord. Help pull away stress and sickness and worry and replace them with peace, love, and joy. Jesus, we love You. We thank You. We accept You. We accept what You have done for us. And we are excited to be the body of Christ here in the middle of Haverhill. Lord, we thank You. We praise You. In the name of our Lord and Savior, the Messiah, Jesus. Amen. Now let us rise and worship the Lord our God. Oh, for those that are in their cars, it's 88.5. Turn it in and listen to it.
That's about the temperature out right now, 88.5.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by Your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. There's nothing worth more that would ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, You are welcome here. Come flood this place grace and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord.
Your presence, Lord. I don't know where everyone in this field is with you, Lord, but I just pray that everyone opens their hearts, that everyone opens and surrenders to you. So good. You are so good, and we just welcome you here at this farm on this beautiful day with such a beautiful breeze. Can we say amen to that? Because it is hot, guys, and I just welcome you to just open your hearts and just take it all in, because God is here and he is present, and we just ask him to call us up, to call us closer to him, and just welcome him here.
I could just sit and wait for all your goodness, hope to feel your presence. And I could just stay, I could just stay right where I am and hope to feel you, hope to feel something again. I could hold on, I could hold on to who I am and never let you change me from the inside. And I could be safe, oh, I could be safe here in your arms and never leave home, never let these walls down. But you have called me higher, you have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You have called me higher, You have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. Will you lead me? Will you lead me, Lord? And I could hold on. I could hold on to who I am and never let you change me from the inside. And I could be safe, oh, I could be safe here in your arms and never leave home. Never let these walls down. You have called me higher. You have called me deeper. And I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. You have called me higher. You have called me deeper. And I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. Will you lead me? Will you lead me, Lord? And I will be yours, Lord. I will be yours for all my life. And I will be yours, Lord. I will be yours for all my life. And I will be yours, Lord. I will be yours for all my life. So let your mercy. And I will be yours, Lord. And I will be yours for all my life. So let your mercy light the path before me. 'Cause you have called me higher. You have called me deeper. And I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. 'Cause you have called me higher. You have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. 'Cause you have called me higher. You have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. 'Cause you have called me higher. You have called me deeper, and I'll go where you will lead me, Lord. Will you lead me? Will you lead me, Lord? Will you lead me? Will you lead me, Lord?
I really love that song that we just sang because it really focuses on the fact that we do have to grow with the Lord and go where he's leading us. And as we jump into this next song called Here Again, which I love as well, it also is just such a great reminder that no matter where we're at, whether we're striving to grow with him or if we're just down in the valley and we're just not feeling anything, he meets us where we are. He meets us in the lowest valleys, and he meets us on the mountaintops. And I think it's so important to remember both of those things, that, you know, we have to go where he's calling us, but to also always remember that he's going to meet us where we are no matter what.
Amen.
Can't go back to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know here in the middle is a place where you promise to be.
I'm not enough. Unless you come, will you meet me here again?
'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
I forgot to introduce you to Pastor James earlier, my brother in Christ. I'm sorry, I forgot you. But here he is now, and he's going to pray for us.
Thank you for the introduction. I really appreciate it. And, you know, being a five, that was really awkward for me. So I'm happy that everybody in the church got to see it. Everybody on Facebook world. Yes, awesome, awesome. Guys, let's give it up for our worship team. They killed it. And I hope you let those songs resonate with you. Not for a minute was I forsaken. Those aren't just words. That's truth. God has never forsaken us, nor will he ever. We are cleansed by the blood of Christ. We are not defined by our sins. We are the children of Christ. We are God's children. So, yep, I am Pastor James. I think he did it because I always forget to introduce myself. I think that's what it is. At least that's what I'm going to tell myself. So I am the discipleship pastor, which is pretty cool to be part of such an amazing movement. To be part of a church that is just barely a year old is just incredible. Just a baby church that is growing fruit over and over. And more importantly, having people see Christ for the very first time. Not religion, but Christ. And it's so important, the differences between man-made religion and Jesus Christ. And we just need to make sure that as just church, we are just the church and just preach the Bible. If I can have you guys bow your heads and close your eyes, I'd love to pray just over our city and just, Lord Jesus, thank you so much. Thank you for everything that you do. You are our King. Lord God, I pray for every single person in this area, on this holy ground. Lord God, I pray for them to just know that they're enough. To know that through you, they are enough. Lord God, allow them to not lean on their own understanding, but just lean on you. Lord God, I pray for everybody here, their family. Lord God, I ask that you just protect them and you just guide them to a closer relationship to you. Lord Jesus, I pray for our beautiful broken city. Lord God, I pray for our beautiful broken state and country. And Lord Jesus, I know that you win. No matter what anything that's coming that's a distraction, no matter what distraction comes, you win. Lord God, allow us to lean on you during these difficult times. Allow us to not focus on the distractions of the world to keep us from you. And Lord God, we just love you so much. And all of us say amen. Amen. All right. And, oh, yes, now this is where I would awkwardly transition to Tammy, but she's not here today. She's on vacation, killing it with Pastor Kevin, which is pretty amazing. So I have the awesome job of talking about the connection cards. So what the connection cards is we're going to be handing them out, and what we do is we'd like for you to just fill out the information, not to bug you, not to sell your information, but to find out who you are and to just be able to pray for you. It's also nice for us to know if you have any prayer requests. So what you can do is on the back of the card, just write down something that you need prayer for. If you don't want to go into detail, that's okay. We don't need to have detail. God knows. But, Jen and Rachel are making fun of me. I can see it. Okay, perfect. So, this is why I'm not a very good public speaker, because I can't deal with the distractions. I love you, Joe. I love you, Joe. So, anyway, so the prayer requests, we'd love it if you would fill them out, so that way we can pray for you throughout the week. And I think we have an amazing song right now that Pastor John picked out for the eights in the crowd to absolutely love. So hit it.
You big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place, singing, we
waving your banner all over the place.
We will rock you.
Sing it.
We will rock you.
Buddy, you're an old man, poor man, pleading with your eyes, gonna make you zombie someday. You got mud on your face, big disgrace. Somebody better put your bag into your place.
To fill out your connection cards. That was the eights song that John chose himself. Most of you knowing that eights, he is an eight himself, so it was quite appropriate. I probably would have chosen something different, like maybe We Are the Champions or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, welcome today. It's great to see all of you here. At Just Church. For those of you who may not know me, my name is Pastor Rachel, and I'm the worship and teaching pastor here, and so I get to bring you the message today. And this message is, we are in, what is it, the ninth week now of our Made in Love series. It seems like we may have just started, and it also seems like we've been in here forever. So, but it's been 9 weeks. It's been completely awesome, I think. Hopefully you're tracking with me there. But this series, the premise of this series is that each one of us was specifically and specially made by God, unique and marvelous. And that each one of us has a true, authentic self that we are coming into. But sometimes that takes work. And as part of that, we're studying what's called the Enneagram. And I know for some of you that may be a new concept, so I just want to give you a little bit of background about that. So, and if you've missed any of our prior messages and you want to catch up with those, I'd encourage you to do that. They're available on our Just Church Facebook page. They're available on our YouTube page. You can take a look out there and catch up with those. But the Enneagram is, at its core, a personality typing tool. But it really is so much more than that. And it really, for me, has been transformational, personally and in our relationships. And I've seen that happen for so many since we've been studying that. And so the Enneagram proposes that each one of us, every human, gravitates towards one of nine general personality types in our young formational years. I'm going to let Emily catch up there. And to help us as little people kind of make sense of this big world. And as a result, we get into one of these nine types of normal to cope with what is happening around us, which we often can't control as children. The problem is, as we grow into adults, sometimes those coping mechanisms do not mature with us. And so we can fall into very unhealthy habits. And sometimes we don't even understand what we do or why we do it. And so the Enneagram can help us make sense of that. The Enneagram helps us understand why we react certain ways so that we can perhaps change those reactions, so that we can, from a biblical perspective, at least that's how we're looking at it, come into that true self that God made us to be. And as I said, our other messages, the last seven types, are all online. You can feel free to go and check those out if you want to catch up on that or figure out perhaps what your type is. Every week also I do a handout, and that's on our webpage, justchurch.net/handout. And that has all of the scriptures that I'm going to use today. And a couple of other notes and some questions that you can review throughout the week that maybe help you think a little bit more about what we've talked about today. So if you want to check that out either during the service or afterwards, you can do that. And I think it's a pretty helpful tool, and I work really hard on it, so don't make me do that for nothing. So today we are going to talk about our type eights, our challengers. Now, of all the types, I believe the type eights have the greatest opportunity to use their superpower for good or for evil. And I also think eights are often quite misunderstood. And so it's important for all of us, even if we're not eights, even if we don't have an eight in a prominent position in our lives, I think it's really important for us to understand about eights. And so let's start with a brief description of eights. Let's find out who they are. As I said, type eights are the challengers. John prefers the name the protectors. You didn't put your shirt on. Oh, he's got a special shirt for today that he didn't change into. But I actually, I like challenger. I think it's a little bit more descriptive of who eights are. But eights make great leaders. They are self-confident. They are assertive and decisive. They can be confrontational when needed. Oh, there it is. There's his shirt. Aww. they can be confrontational when needed, and sometimes even when not needed, perhaps. They can also be a little bit egocentric and domineering sometimes. And they eights often try to control their environment around them, and even sometimes the people around them, which can lead them sometimes to being quite unhealthy in the manner of which they go about their confrontation, even to the extent that sometimes they can be very intimidating. Now, when eights are healthy, as we said, they make great leaders. They use their strength, and that's the eight's key characteristic, their strength, to improve others' lives. And that can actually cause them to become quite heroic and noble and inspiring. And as we have with all the other types, we're going to look at the type 8 through a biblical lens, this time through a category of people, God's prophets, and a specific prophet, and that's going to be Nathan. Now, as we've said, type 8s are called the challengers. And if you know anything about God's prophets, that's a pretty perfect description of who the prophets were, because they were specifically called by God to challenge things that were happening around them, actions of sometimes a person or a group of people. And they have been, as I said, specifically called and chosen by God to bring his word of repentance. And as you can imagine, that was not an easy gig most of the time. And so here, as I said, we're going to focus on one prophet in particular, and that's Nathan. Now, you may recall hearing about Nathan in a prior story that we told during our Type 4 week. And Type 4s, remember, they're the individualists, they're the romantics. And we talked about King David during that week. And actually, we talked a little bit about King David last week, because David was the father of Solomon. Solomon was our example of our type 7. But David was our example of our type 4. And in fact, Solomon was the son of David and Bathsheba. And so if you recall the story of David and Bathsheba, we talked about that on our type 4 week. But you may not recall Nathan, because he only plays a little role, but a very, very important role in that story. So we're going to back up to that story of David and Bathsheba for a minute. And if you were with us during our Type 4 week, you might remember that. If you weren't, I'm going to do a quick recap just for those who may not know that story. So King David is on the roof of his palace, and he's overlooking the city, and he sees Bathsheba. And she's beautiful. And in fact, he doesn't just see her. She's actually bathing. And so he sees her, he says, she's so incredibly beautiful. He asks one of his people, who is that? And they tell him, that's Bathsheba. She's the wife of Uriah the Hittite. And he says, go get her and bring her to me. And so they go get her. As you can imagine, when you're summoned to the palace, the king calls you at that time. You don't really have much of a choice but to go. And David sleeps with her. Long story short, Bathsheba becomes pregnant. And again, once again, in case you missed this, she's a married woman. So David, through different plans and plotting, winds up as king, ordering Bathsheba's husband, Uriah, to the front lines, where he is killed. Okay? And so that brings us to where we are here with our man this week, Nathan. So we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 12, and remember, if you were with us last week, we talked about the kings of Israel, and I said that those are found in 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1 Kings, and 2 Kings, and remember, this is part of the Old Testament, so these are the books of the Bible that were written about the time prior to Jesus' life and ministry here on earth. So we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 12, starting in verse 1. And it says, so the Lord sent Nathan the prophet to tell David this story. There were two men in a certain town. One was rich and one was poor. The rich man owned a great many sheep and cattle. The poor man owned nothing but one little lamb he had bought. He raised that little lamb and grew it up with his children. It ate from the man's own plate and drank from his cup. He cuddled it in his arms like a baby daughter. One day, a guest arrived at the home of the rich man, but instead of killing an animal from his own flock or herd, he took the poor man's lamb and killed it and prepared it for his guest. David was furious. As surely as the Lord lives, he vowed, any man who would do such a thing deserves to die. He must repay four lambs to the poor man for the one he stole, for having no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are that man. Now Nathan goes on and he delivers a much longer message about David's actions and his need to repent and how very wrong his actions were. But I want to stop there because I think that's really indicative of who Nathan was and what he had to say. And this we have to understand, this is an epic showdown right here. Because David is the king. I mean, he's larger than life here. And he's a four, so some fours can be larger than life, right? Yeah, shaking your head there, yeah. He's the king of Israel, and he has all the might and the power that comes with that role. And then there's Nathan, the challenger, right? The type eight. And so as we have with other types, we're going to look at the superpower that eights bring to our lives and to this world. And that superpower is their strength. They have this unique ability to reflect God's strength. Now, I just want to pull back for a second and say to any of you who are parents out there who may be raising little eights, as I know Emily may be here, it can be a rough gig. Raising an eight can be difficult. They're not called the challengers for nothing, okay? They challenge everything. From the time they can talk, and maybe even before, they challenge everything. And all I can say to any of you who have experienced this or who are experiencing right now or who will experience it in the future, hold on, mama or daddy, because they're going to make it worth it. I guarantee you. Some of you know our third daughter, Bella. And she is possibly the eightest eight that I've ever met in my life of knowing eights. And I am married to an eight. And she is a force to be reckoned with, literally since the day she was born. My mom used to describe her as spicy, and I think that was as complimentary as you could get. Fierce. She did, yeah, she called her fierce. My mom used to say that she was either going to be the CEO of a major corporation or in jail. So far, she's neither, but some of you know that she joined the Navy last year, and she has been wildly successful since that time. She is just flourishing. She graduated boot camp in the top six of her class out of over 1,300 recruits. I mean, just amazing. And so she's born for it, and she's doing incredible. And she has a very successful career in Navy intelligence ahead of her, by all accounts that we're seeing right now. And the last trip, we just took a trip to see her about a month ago on her base, and John reminded me that I used to threaten her with military school, because let me tell you, teenage years were rough. And then he said, but you realize that she actually chose it for herself eventually. So eights will make it worth your while. I promise you, if you have an eight in your life, they are the challengers, but they will make it worth your while. They reflect God's strength. They're strong and they're confident and they know what needs to be done and they know what they need you to do to get there. They're not wishy-washy. They're not tossed to and fro. They're going to tell you exactly what they want. As I mentioned, John is an eight. We have a few other eights sprinkled throughout the crowd. Bernie's actually waving, so I'll point him out. I wasn't going to point anybody out, but but if the eights are waving, then I have to point them out. So, you may have heard John say before, he says it a lot, you need to be long-suffering in the same direction. And that's a very eight thing to say. He knows what needs to be done. It's a mindset. And he's willing to do whatever it takes to get there. And he'd really like you to come with him, but if you don't, he might just roll you over. So, as we said, they're great leaders. And at their core, really, eights want to see the world be better. They want to see the world be more just. And with their strength, they have the opportunity to stand up for those without a voice. And a couple of great examples of healthy eight leaders. The first one, Martin Luther King. He was a world changer, man. You know, because he stood there and he said, black people are not being treated fairly. And he stood up to the strongest, most powerful nation on earth and said, this is not right. This needs to change. Okay? Another great eight leader was Winston Churchill. And I don't know how many of you know your World War history, but when all of Europe was essentially bowing down to Germany, right? England was essentially defeated, no chance. He gave a historic speech, and he said, we will never, ever, ever surrender. And he rallied the United States to get involved, to stand up and to do what's right and true, and eventually we were successful against Adolf Hitler and the Nazis. So eights are incredibly effective leaders, and largely that is because they communicate very directly. And like Nathan did, he stood up to David and simply said, he told his story, he told the creative story that he needed to speak to David's creative individualist heart, but then he said, you are that man. And David, look at him, he's furious. He hears the story, right? He hears the story, he gets invested in the story. He's ready to enact the death penalty for this guy who took the poor man's lamb, right? And Nathan just stands right up to him and he says, you are that man. You stole this guy's wife and you ultimately stole his life. Now here's another thing that it's important for you to know about eights. They're a lot like eggs, okay? So they have this hard shell on the outside, but then if you can get onto the inside, they're pretty gooey inside, okay? Now, I like to think of them as like those Cadbury chocolate eggs, right? There's that shell around the outside, but man, when you get in there, there's some good stuff in there. And so there's that gooey stuff, and who are they gooey for? They're gooey for those they love and for those that they see as needing protection. That's where that term, the protector, comes from. They look out for those who are not as strong as they are. Those who are unable to protect themselves, who are unable to stand up for themselves. But because they have that hard shell on the outside, sometimes eights need that reminder to be tender, to be soft, to be gentle, to allow those who love them to get in to that gooey center. And eights, I want to talk to you right now and just tell you, you need to be particularly intentional and aware of that, particularly with those that you are closest to, because they will take the brunt of some of those wonderful characteristics that we talked about earlier, that self-confidence, that assertiveness, that domineering nature. And so eights need to be really intentional about pursuing tenderness and mercy. And those who love eights, we need to be intentional about creating a space where the eights can feel safe doing this. Because it is difficult for them to be vulnerable and to be real. If you love an eight, it may be really hard to understand how they feel. And you know why? Because they're not going to readily share that with you. And in fact, if they're feeling insecure, they're going to be more forceful. They're going to be more insensitive. They're going to be more combative. And when they're unhealthy, eights are relationally clueless. An unhealthy eight, if they're working towards something, if they have a goal, no matter how much it's affecting others, they don't see it. It's not that they don't care. They just don't even see it. They're not going to read your body language. I'm going to tell you right now, eights do not understand nuance or subtlety. So don't expect them to get it. You've got to tell them what you want them to know. You've got to tell them that if they're doing something that's hurting you, you've got to tell them that. It's not personal. They just don't understand it. Now, remember how I said that eights may be the type to have the greatest opportunity to use their superpower for good or for evil. We talked a little bit about Winston Churchill. We talked about example of how he's a great eight leader. Stood up to Adolf Hitler and the Nazis, rallied everybody together, and ultimately were able to defeat them. But you know who else was also an eight? Adolf Hitler. He had strength, right? He certainly did a great job of getting people rallied behind him, getting them together. He just used that superpower for evil rather than for good. So as we have with the other types, we need to talk about what motivates our eights. What's behind that? What's their core sin? And with eights, that might be a little bit awkward here, okay? But as Pastor James found out, when you know and love an eight, almost everything's awkward. So it's okay. They're confrontational. So if you're a type that's not confrontational, get ready. It's going to be awkward. So eight's core sin is lust. But see, as we talked about last week with the sevens, we talked about gluttony, and we often think about gluttony as having specifically to do with food. We do the same thing with lust. We think lust is just about sex, right? But that is not always the case. I'll give you an example, however, of a biblical eight who was taken down by his lust, his lustful nature, his lust being of a sexual nature, and that is Samson. Samson was incredibly powerful. If you want to read about Samson, his story is in the book of Judges. Again, we're back in the good old Testament there. Judges chapter 12 through 16 is all about Samson. But in chapter 16, we hear about Samson and a woman named Delilah. Now, Samson was incredibly powerful. He was filled with God's Holy Spirit, but he was also completely blinded by his lust for this woman, Delilah. And she even tried to kill him, okay? And he still didn't get it. Like, he's still all about her. And he could not get past that sexual desire, and eventually it was his ruin, and he did die. Like I said, you can read about that in Judges chapter 16. But in general, when we talk about lust with relative to the eights being that their core sin, it's that insatiable desire that is overwhelming. And oftentimes, eights' lust is displayed by the overwhelming need to be in control or to have power. That's the core need of eights, to be in control. Now, some of you may be like, yep, that's definitely me. I definitely want to be in control. And for some eights, that's it. For some eights, though, you might be sitting there saying, that's me, and that's not me. I don't identify with that at all. But let me phrase it another way for those eights. Maybe you don't need to be in control, but I think you probably don't like to be controlled, okay? And there is a slight distinction between those two, but most eights who say, you know what, I don't need to be in control of every situation, they may not relate to that, but they definitely relate to the idea of not wanting to be controlled. So let me tell you right now, when John and I do something together, we have a very hard time collaborating, okay? He has no trouble doing something that I ask him to, but he wants to do it the way he wants to do it. If I want to sit there and tell him and give him some input about how to do it, he doesn't want to take that. He wants that freedom, that lack of being controlled, to accomplish it in his own way, even if that way is stupid and not the right way. And that's the one in me coming out. He wants to be able to do it his own way. And that's that eight. That eight doesn't want to be controlled. And the fact of the matter is that we actually work really well together. We have our own areas, and as long as we stay in our own lanes, it works out pretty well. So the question is with those eights, as we talked about, how can we get to that nice gooey stuff on the outside without totally cracking that shell? Because that shell, again, it's their superpower. It's their strength. We don't want to get rid of it. We just need to find a way through it so we can access the good stuff inside, right? Like, I talked to you about those Cadbury eggs. Like, I'm not a huge fan of chocolate. I like chocolate. I'll eat chocolate. But, man, sugar. I love sugar. So that stuff that's inside those Cadbury eggs, that's the stuff that I want, okay? So that's what we need to figure out, is how do we get to that stuff without ruining the chocolate on the outside, without ruining that hard shell, that strength. So I'm going to give you some tips today as someone who's been married to an eight now for 26 years. Is that right? I don't know. Been together over 30. We've been married for 26 years. Here's some tips on 27. Okay, sorry. I missed one. Whoop. Oh, there goes our cross. Glad nobody was on the platform. That praise God. 27 years. It was during Corona, so I forgot the last anniversary. So here are some tips on how to love an eight. And it doesn't matter if that eight is your spouse or if it's just someone in your life. It could be a coworker. Coworkers who are eights, that can be a rough gig. It can be your child. It can be someone you're raising. So how to love an eight. Number one, when they are vulnerable or tender, even with something small, notice that, acknowledge it, and encourage them. And that doesn't mean you make a big fanfare about it, right? You know, they're like the fives in that sense. They don't want you to tell everybody that they were just vulnerable. But tell them that you realize that that took a lot for them to do that. And just appreciate it. Appreciate that vulnerability when they show it. Number two, stand up for yourselves. Eights are not called the challengers for nothing. They like a good verbal sparring, okay? And they will be okay with you challenging back. In fact, they probably will enjoy it, right? John and I went through a lot of heartache when we were younger because I didn't understand that that was just his communication style. It's not a style that's comfortable for me, but now that we've been together for a while and I'm just too old to care or worry about it, we can get into a nice verbal skirmish and it comes out and then he's fine at the end. He's like, oh yeah, I didn't realize that. Okay, I'm good with that now. I usually wind up leaving like, but it's okay, it works out. So don't be afraid to challenge them. They're going to respect that. They're going to understand that, and eventually it can bring you to a very, very healthy place. Number three. When you don't agree with an eight, talk to them straight about why. Tell them why you don't agree with them. See, what happens is eight's approach oftentimes becomes the focus rather than whatever issue you're talking about. Those of us who are perhaps a little bit more sensitive, and we're all more sensitive than eights, okay? So those of us who may be a little bit more sensitive are going to focus on the fact that our feelings are hurt, that the way you're saying that to me is hurtful. And that's what we're going to start talking about, rather than talking about the substance of whatever it is. And eights aren't going to understand that, because if they're focused on something, they don't care that your feelings are hurt. And not only do they not care, they don't even see that your feelings are hurt. And it's irrelevant to them. They're not going to be able to focus on that. So if you start by being direct with them and tell them why you don't agree with them, you can have that conversation. You can get through that. And then once you've gotten through that, then you can have the conversation of, hey, by the way you said that really hurt my feelings, and here's why. And I think it will be easier for them to receive that because they've gotten the focus of whatever they wanted to talk about, whatever they wanted to do, out of the way. But if you talk about it before that, they won't get it. So have conversations with them and be direct. And the last one is, don't assume that they intend to be hurtful, because they generally don't. They're often just trying to get their point across. And your feelings to that point are irrelevant. And that's not intended to be mean. It's just reality. They're just trying to convey something to you. And the way that you feel doesn't matter in that moment. But you've got to know that eight heart. You've got to understand that gooey stuff is in there. I promise you, it's in there. No matter how hard that shell is, that gooey stuff is in there. And you've got to recognize that eights are going to be much more blunt than everyone else. They're just going to give it to you straight. But they're going to tell you what you need to hear in some circumstances. And let me tell you, we live in a world that a lot of people will tell you what you want to hear. And sometimes we need to hear certain things. And eights will be honest with you, and they will give it to you straight. Because remember, without Nathan, David doesn't repent. He doesn't get his life right with God. He doesn't go on to write the book of Psalms, and he doesn't go on to govern the nation of Israel the way that he did. We need eights to talk to us straight and to speak the truth. Now, eights, you need to speak the truth in love and with mercy and tenderness. And so I want to talk to our eights now for a minute. or maybe you have just an eight wing or something, or maybe you have eight tendencies, even if you haven't really figured out what your type is. So if that's the case, I want to talk to you for a second. And I want to start off with a Bible verse. So this is from James chapter 2. And so, again, James comes from the New Testament now. So now we're in the time that's during the life of Jesus or afterwards. This is actually afterwards. So this is being written by the Apostle James. And chapter 2, starting in verse 12, James says, "So whatever you say or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law that sets you free. There will be no mercy for those who have not shown mercy to others. But if you have been merciful, God will be merciful when he judges you." So as Christ followers, we are called to extend God's mercy to others. And that especially goes for you eights, because you can wield God's strength. You have the strength. You have the ability to lead. You have the ability to make a huge difference in this world. But with that ability comes responsibility, right? So if I'm to quote Uncle Ben from Spider-Man, right? He said, "With great power comes great responsibility." And so, eights, you have to understand that. You have to understand that when you speak, it's going to have power. And you have the power to speak life into people, or you have the power to strip them down. And as our scripture tells us, someday every one of us is going to have to stand before God and answer for the way we live. Now, if you are in Christ Jesus, scripture tells us there is no condemnation. But that doesn't mean that there isn't judgment. That doesn't mean that you're still not going to have to answer for our actions, for our sins. And so, eights, you just need to recognize that you have power. And if you want to be healthy, if you really want to press into this, you need to understand that you're almost always going to be stronger than many of those around you. And you're often going to be more powerful than those around you. And the question is, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to use it like Martin Luther King or like Winston Churchill? Or are you going to use it like Adolf Hitler? Now, obviously, those are extremes there. There's a whole bunch in the middle. But the decision is yours, eights. So I want to pull up another scripture, actually, from the book of James again. And this is from chapter 3, verse 17. And it says, "But the wisdom from above is first of all pure. It is also peace-loving, gentle at all times, and willing to yield to others. It is full of mercy and the fruit of good deeds. It shows no favoritism and is always sincere." And so to our eights, I want to make sure you just heard those words that we said. Peace-loving, gentle, willing to yield to others, full of mercy, sincere. Now, those are fairly different than the less flattering ways we described dates in the beginning: confrontational, assertive, domineering, having trouble being real. In fact, they might be seen as exact opposites. So if you have a Bible with you, or if you have your YouVersion or a whatever you have, find a Sharpie if you're an eight and write it on your hand. These words right here: willing to yield to others. Because I want to be real with you for a second, eights, and I know that's not easy. You cannot be a Christ follower without following Christ. It's right there in the name, right? You have to be willing to yield to him. And if you're going to be his follower, guess what? You're going to have to yield to others as well. Because even Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. Even Jesus washed the feet of his disciples. We're not called to domineer over others and to wear others down by challenging them until they agree about how great Jesus is, right? We're to show them the love of Jesus as a servant leader through grace and mercy. And we can't do that by wielding power over everyone around us. That's not going to show Jesus' love and his servant heart. And so, eights, hear this. Coming to a place that James is talking about here, that's going to be a lifelong process for you. Because unhealthy eights will say, "It's my way or the highway." But healthy eights will say, "Here's what I see needs to happen. But I'm open to hearing what you think." Full of mercy, full of grace. Now, there's a lot of people in your lives, eights, who you're going to think are not as competent as you are. Who you may think, frankly, are idiots. And you know what? You may be right. But here's the thing. It's not your job to control the idiots, okay? Your job as a Christ follower is to love them and lead them into a relationship with Jesus. For you to be a disciple, to be conformed in the image of Christ, and to help others to become his disciples and to be conformed to his image, not your image of who they should be. He's given you strength and power, not to be used for your good, but to be used for his glory. So as we close, I want you to listen to what the Apostle Paul wrote to the church in Corinth. And here he's relaying a message that was given to him by the Lord in response to his prayer. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul wrote, "My grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ can work through me. That's why I take pleasure in my weaknesses and in the insults, hardships, persecutions, and troubles that I suffer for Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong." We are all stronger when we can share our weaknesses. Have you ever heard somebody give a testimony that went like this? "There was this day, and I almost messed up really, really badly. But thankfully, I was strong enough that I didn't. And then my life was changed forever." No. No, the greatest testimonies generally come from someone's pit of despair when they were completely broken down and weak. And God came in and pulled them out of the muck and the mire and the pit. And through his strength, he changed their hearts and their lives. So eights, I want to make sure you don't deprive the world of that testimony, of your testimony. Be real. Admit that you can't do things by yourself. Let some of us idiots help you. We all have to work together. Let that gooey inside come out. Because your superpower is your strength, and it is a superpower, but if you allow it to be God's strength, and remember that in our weakness, God's glory shows through, and he is made strong. Let's go to prayer. God, we thank you. We thank you for our eights. We thank you for their leadership. We thank you for their strength. We thank you for their ability to know what needs to be done and their willingness to do what it is until that is accomplished. And God, we just pray for our eights that they can use that power, that they can use that strength well, so that they can lead, so that they can lead others into a relationship with you, God. God, we pray that we can see that gooey center in our eights, that they can learn that it's okay to be vulnerable, that it's okay to show those weaknesses. God, let us see their hearts, and for those of us who love eights, those of us who have eights in our lives, in whatever capacity it may be, I pray that you would give us the heart and the eyes that you see them with, that you can see those wonderful things inside them. Let us know that heart that just seeks good and justice for others. And I just pray that you would give each of us patience when we have these encounters that may be difficult, and give our eights that heart of tenderness and mercy. And God, most of all, as we are almost done with this series, this Enneagram series, help each one of us to realize our true selves that you have made us to be. Help us to grow into that authenticity, to grow into that purpose and that place that you've called us to, that we may be our highest and best for the building of your kingdom here on earth. We thank you and we praise you. And we lift all of this up in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen.
As we talked about before, Pastor Kevin is on vacation this week, so I'm going to pass this over to P. Johnny, and he's going to bring our offering today.
Yes. Thank you so much, hon. That message was amazing. And this whole series has been so uplifting, and I know so many are getting so much out of it. And we're going to continue to learn how we are made in love. But right now, we're going to take the offering as our team's going to lead us in worship. And I just wanted to, we're going to pray over our offerings in a minute. Gabe's going to go around. If you need an envelope, just raise your hand and he'll bring one to you. But I just wanted to share a story, or not a story, but what's been going on. You know, obviously we have offerings and we take those, and we have when PayPal stuff happens, it all hits my email, so I see when people are giving it, and that's not a thing. I mean, I don't judge or anything. But what was real interesting is I know some of our young folks are starting to work, and then to see them taking their tithe. And even though they're making not a lot of money, but they're starting out right out of the beginning of their earnings and taking that and giving that back to God, because that's where it comes from. And they don't give to get, one of them said to me, but because they are given, they're being blessed. And that's just the way it works. That's just the universal laws of God. It's like gravity. So I just wanted to share that with you. I thought it was super cool, and I, you know a little bit of my story with giving, and I had a hard time for a long time, and I felt like I had to, take my resources, probably my eightness. I had to take my resources, and I had to take care of my family. But we didn't truly get blessed until I finally was able to surrender to God's best, and then he blessed us, and I beyond I could ever imagine. It's unbelievable. So I just say, let you know that, because it's just an awesome thing of God. So let us hold up our offerings, and let's just pray and share our lives and our with each other. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for what you give us. We thank you for all the provisions you provide us, whether it be monetarily or spiritually or physically and relationally. Lord, we are so thankful. And we just want to right now just say to you that we love you. We love you beyond anything. And then we want to see ourselves, and we want to see others in your eyes, with your eyes. So help us to do that, Lord. Help us to understand the things of this world as you see them, and put our lives in that right order so that we can have amazing peace and relationships, and that all the other junk of this life would fall away, and that we would only have the good stuff. So, Father, we pray over these offerings. We ask you to bless them and multiply them for your kingdom, so others can come to know your love. And we pray this in the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Now, let us rise and worship the Lord our God.
This next song holds a very special place in my heart. And I oftentimes, when I get stuck in that despair, I think about how lost I am and how I can't find my way out. But God in my life has time and time again proven that he is there to take me through, to guide me through that storm so that I can stand on my own two feet with his love, and I can be the man that he has designed me to be. And I know that he can do that for each and every one of you. He's doing that for my brother right now, who's just decided to go into rehab, and he's getting sober, and God has done it over and over again for so many people here. I see so many faces who have overcome their afflictions and the disease, and it's just such a gift when we finally surrender our lives to God and to trust in him that he will bring us through. So as you sing this song today with me, I ask that you surrender yourself to him and trust that he will bring you through again and again and again, because that's what our God is. He surrendered his life so that he could bring us through. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Oh, oh, oh. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. Waiting for change to come. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Oh, 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 oh. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. You never fail me.
Never fail me yet.
is so, so very good.
Amen.
Even in the difficult times. Some of you know that this is a song that means a lot. We tend to do it in times of great trouble and when we need to be reminded. And some of you know that we lost someone really dear to us this last week. And this is the second time in less than 5 months. And so But nevertheless, even though we stand here and some of us are in tears and we miss Corey and we're so sad that he's not here with us anymore, God is still good. And he is going to do it again. He's going to show his power and his might through each one of us. And he is going to be victorious. As we said, victorious in the end. We know who wins. We've read the end of the book. And we know how that's going to happen. And so even though I don't know what you're going through in your life, but if you are going through struggles, and I think I can pretty much say I don't care how bad they are, because we've been through some real struggles. God can still work. You are still worth it to him. And he can still make something great and beautiful out of whatever mess you're going through right now. Believe that with me here. God, we stand on those promises. We stand on the knowledge that you will work in amazing ways through each and every one of us, through this church, through this city. God, we pray that your spirit, we know that your spirit is coming. We pray that your spirit is here in revival, and we know that you will do great things right here where we are. And we thank you and we praise you. And we lift all of this up, God, in your mighty, mighty name as our Father in heaven. And we lift this up in the name of God and the person of Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for each and every one of us. And we lift this up in the name of God and the person of the Holy Spirit, who lives with and in each one of us and is working in this place right now. Amen and amen. It is always an honor to be in worship with you. What a great day that God has given us here today. Celebrate it. Tell those that you love them. Don't waste a single moment. God is so, so good. Love you all. Have a wonderful, wonderful, amazing week. Amen.
I see you move the mountains, 'cause I believe. I see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, 'cause I believe. I see you do it again. I see you move the mountains, 'cause I believe. I see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, 'cause I believe. I see you do it again. I see you move. You move the mountains, 'cause I believe. I see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way, 'cause I believe. I see you do it again.